Macmillan Audio presents Observer by Robert Lanza and Nancy Kress. Read for you by Stacey Glemboski.
The usual approach of science, of constructing a mathematical model, cannot answer the question of why there should be a universe for the model to describe. Why does the universe go to the bother of existing? Stephen Hawking, A Brief History of Time. Prologue. No one wanted to tell the old man. They clustered in a courtyard outside his bedroom, under the wide overhang that sheltered the walkway. The residential wing, one of three, had been built in a square around a central courtyard at the western end of the compound to catch the slanting rays of the morning sun. This early, barely after dawn, the air was still fresh and cool, with the clean, salty zing of a breeze off the Caribbean. Nonetheless, the three people could hear the AC going full blast behind the old man's closed door. James, head of household staff, wearing slippers and a flamboyant silk robe that would not have been out of place in 1940s Hollywood, had been among those alerted by the night duty tech as soon as the police arrived. Julian had gone with the police to identify the body. Two of Julian's security techs, sent to inform the old man of what had happened, looked expectantly at James. He tightened the belt of his robe and said, "I don't see why we have to wake him at all. There's nothing for Dr. Watkins to do. He's old and very ill. Let him sleep." The techs didn't answer, but their glances at each other spoke terabytes. Only someone not directly involved in the project would think that Dr. Watkins wouldn't want to know instantly what had happened. But it was James who had the inspiration. "I know. Wake Dr. Weigert." Weigert had not been called already, because Julian had left strict instructions that Weigert was never to talk to island police. The two young techs suspected the reason was Weigert's sometimes indiscreet openness. They did not say this aloud. But now the police had gone. The techs nodded, and James phoned Weigert. He, too, arrived in slippers and robe, although his was of faded terry cloth that looked older than all three young men. James explained in great detail what the police had told him. Weigert nodded slowly and knocked on the bedroom door.
"What the? Oh, it's you, George. What is it?"
Weigert entered the bedroom, as small and whitewashed as all the others set around the courtyard, although even more bare. Neither luxury nor home decoration interested Watkins. He never put personal bits and pieces on the walls or dresser. Weigert discovered that it wasn't AC he'd heard through the door, but a noisy space heater. The room was a sauna. Was that necessary for Sam's condition? Weigert, a physicist rather than a physician, had no idea.
"Sam, there's been an accident."
Samuel Lewis Watkins, genius Nobel laureate, switched on the bedside lamp and heaved himself upright in bed. Cheekbones sharp as chisels, bald head shining in the lamplight.
"What kind of accident? Are the data and equipment safe?"
"Yes, they are. It's a diving accident. David Weeks. He's dead. Julian just left with the police to identify the body. But apparently there's no doubt it's Dr. Weeks."
Weigert, who had known Sam since their university days and who disliked confrontation, braced himself for a tsunami of expletives. Sam had told Weeks to cease diving. No, not told, ordered. The tsunami didn't come. Instead, Watkins adopted the intense, focused look that meant his remarkable brain was processing multiple ideas, imagining, synthesizing, evaluating. That brain had gotten them all here, in this remote island compound in the Caribbean, where Weigert, at least, had certainly never expected to be. But all Watkins said was,
"Tell me."
Weeks must have gone out last night. Julian hasn't had time yet to check the surveillance log. The police said that Dr. Weeks's body was discovered this morning, snagged near the top of a coral reef by some fisherman. He'd dropped his weight belt, and his buoyancy device was partially inflated, which was why the body rose. His fins had the address of the compound painted on them. The police said there was no sign of any violence by sharks, or humans, or anything like that, and that probably Weeks had a heart attack or something, and tried to get out of the water, but died first. Watkins said, "Damn idiot. I told him not to." He looked away at the whitewashed wall. "Yes," Weigert said, because what else was there to say? Warmth and light abruptly poured through the open door. The sun had topped the compound walls. Watkins was silent for a long time. Weigert couldn't tell from his old friend's face if Sam was thinking of personal memories of David Weeks, brought into the project a year ago, or of the project itself, now short a crucial member whose loss could jeopardize everything. It had not been easy to find a neurosurgeon willing to perform the unusual operations that the project called for. When the silence stretched on and on, and then on some more, Weigert couldn't stand it.
"Sam, should I?"
"You don't have to do anything." And then,
"George, I'm running out of time."
Weigert, startled by the reference to what everyone knew but no one ever mentioned in Sam's presence, didn't know what to say. He settled on honesty.
"I know. Of course you do. I'm sure everybody knows, right down to James's kitchen help. All right, send for Haggerty."
"The lawyer?" Bill Haggerty, another old friend of Watkins, was the only one connected with the compound who lived not only off-site, but off-island. All communication with him was through heavily encrypted email.
"Yes, tell him to come today."
"But today?"
"Today."
And then, with a grimace on that disease-ravaged face,
"Our project is too important to the future not to have thought of all eventualities. I have a plan B."
One. 3 months earlier. When Caro walked out of the hospital administrator's office, her legs felt wobbly. She stiffened them and, head held high, did not glance back at the doctors seated around the conference table. None of them followed her out, giving her time, a courtesy she recognized but did not appreciate. These people had just destroyed her future. In the corridors of Fairleigh Memorial Hospital, she willed herself to walk steadily, to return the impersonal nods of a resident, a medical student, to administrative assistants. The elevator was full. She took the fire stairwell. Its emptiness, silent except for the ring of her shoes on metal steps, was welcome. She was catastrophizing, she told herself. There were other hospitals. Not here. Not for her talents. She could have not reported Paul Becker. No, she'd done the right thing. She could have not asked Maisie to speak at the hearing. But that one was still too painful to think about. Caro had thought that Maisie was a friend. She'd thought a lot of things that, it turned out, weren't true. What did you do when everything you'd wanted had been in clear sight and then slipped through your highly trained fingers? At the bottom of the stairwell, Caro pushed open the heavy door and walked past the restrooms. And there, seated on a backless ottoman that was supposed to discourage lobby sitters and never did, was the last person Caro wanted to see. Ellen jumped up.
"Caro! Oh, the hearing went against you."
Her sister could always read Caro, even when no one else could, even when Caro didn't want to be read or even seen.
"Ellen, I don't want to talk about it."
"Of course you don't. You never do. But you have to.
It will just be worse if you bottle it all up. Ellen believed in never bottling up anything, in keeping a positive attitude, in finding the bright side. Which was remarkable, considering what Ellen's life had become. Caro's respect for Ellen was enormous. But now, her sense of unreality about what had just happened took on another layer. Disbelief that she, and not Ellen, was the one in trouble. It belied their entire childhoods, girlhoods, adult lives. Their playbook had been written early. Ellen floundered, and big sister Caro rescued. Today, along with everything else the day meant, was a reversal of fact that upended the universe. "You're coming with me," Ellen said. "Now." "No, don't tell me you have a patient or a meeting or a surgery, because I know you have the rest of the day free. You told me so yesterday. We're getting in my car, which is illegally parked out front, even if I have to physically drag you there." And then, in a different voice, "Caro, you know how hard it was for me to make arrangements to get here." Caro knew. She knew, too, that Ellen was capable, both physically and emotionally, of carrying out her threat. Ellen was built like a linebacker. Caro weighed 126 pounds. "Ellen never minds whom she embarrasses. I cannot teach that child restraint." "All right, I'm coming," Caro said. The lobby teemed with people. A nurse pushing a smiling, homegoing patient in a wheelchair. An entire happy family trailing alongside. Dr. Trilling from radiology in a tremendous hurry. Two med students carrying paper cups of Starbucks coffee. One said, "Hello, Dr. Soames-Watkins," and then went on talking to the other. A normal conversation. The students didn't know what had just happened to her. Theoretically, no one would know, because hospital ethics hearings were not public. But after 4 years of medical school, years of neurosurgery residency with research, and her year of fellowship, Caro knew that hospitals did not work like that. Nothing stayed secret for very long. Ellen's car had been ticketed. She shoved the ticket in her purse without looking at it and drove several blocks to an ersatz Irish bar. "In the middle of the afternoon?" Caro said. "You need a drink."
"I don't."
"You can't tell me that the—"
"Oh, all right. You can have an iced tea or something."
The bar was dim and nearly empty. Vaguely Celtic music played, one wordless song blending into the next. They slid into a booth with hard wooden benches. Ellen, whose shaggy dark hair needed not only cutting, but combing, said to the server, "Two iced teas, please." From Ellen, this was equivalent to surrendering her sword and bending the knee. Caro forced a smile. And then, all at once, she was glad that Ellen had brought her here, where she could unburden herself to the person she most loved and trusted. Ellen said, "So, the disciplinary committee didn't believe you?" Caro said, with a superhuman effort, "They didn't want to. Same outcome."
"But you had a witness. You told me that other doctor, your friend, Maisie, somebody."
"Not my friend. Not anymore." Then the hurt under the six simple words broke to the surface, and Caro put her hands over her face. Gently, Ellen pulled them down. Caro's right hand tightened on Ellen's and did not let go. Ellen said, "Sissy?" The hearing came down to he said, she said. Maisie wasn't a direct witness. No one else was upstairs at the party when Paul, Dr. Becker, dragged me into that bedroom. I insisted that Maisie be called to the committee because she'd seen that Becker was pretty drunk, and she knew that we were among the last to leave the party because our Uber didn't show up. Also, that I went upstairs to get my coat and came down upset and with a button torn off my shirt. And I told Maisie the same night what had just happened. She knew. But in the disciplinary hearing, right after Becker denied everything, Maisie did too. She said that she saw nothing and I told her nothing.
She lied? Said Ellen, who never lied. Why?
She was protecting herself, of course. I don't think you realize how influential Paul Becker is. He's not only chief of neurosurgery, he has a brilliant international reputation, and he's the best surgeon I ever saw, a rock star. Last week, I watched him tease out a glioblastoma multiforme with no clean surgical plane, one that no one else could have so much as debulked, let alone never touched the brain tissue.
I don't care. He's an asshole. He tried to rape you.
I don't think it would have gone that far.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.